This show is furnished by Angela Marsden.
Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to SOS Los Angeles, Family Food and Little Guy. It's Saturday, and it's a special Saturday because it's right before Mother's Day. And Angela, we're here to celebrate Mother's Day today.
Absolutely. It's a beautiful weekend, and I just want to say hello to all the mothers out there. I hope you're going to a spa. I hope you are pampering yourself. Maybe get away from the kids a little bit would be nice. I'm lucky enough to have my mom coming into town, and we have a special guest, Roxanne Hoge.
We have the super mom. And, you know, I want to say, too, you know, it's amazing how much parents fight for their kids. Look, I'm a dad. I know my day's coming. I'll give you my address on the air later so you could send me something. But it's amazing how parents stand up for their kids. And that's really what a lot of this is about. And we've got Roxanne Hoge, the super mom, as you ran for county supervisors. That's how you kind of build yourself, right?
I did. I was a super mom for supervisor. It didn't work out quite the way we wanted it to, but it's an important that each of us becomes a hero of our own lives and stands up for what's right. And in Southern California, we have a lot of opportunities to do that.
Roxanne, you literally are a super mama. You're one of the few people I get tired when I just talk to you over the activities. I mean, you, and by the way, how many movies, and she always says, I'm not a star. But to me, a star is anybody that's been more than like 800 movies. And you've been like how many parts, how many films?
You know, I have to say the advent of IMDb, the Internet Movie Database, was really helpful because I have been in Los Angeles for over 30 years and there's stuff on there that I had forgotten. So every once in a while, I'll see someone and they say, remember this? And I go, no. And then I get to look it up and find out that, yes, I was actually in Father the Bride Part 2 or whatever it was. So I've had the privilege of being a journeyman actor for a long time, but my biggest privilege was being the mother to my four kids. So
that's awesome. I remember when I first met you and how blown away I was at how strong you were as a woman and what that must have meant to your kids, because one thing that we're trying to inspire with SOS Los Angeles is saying, like, look, don't leave, stay and fight. And you embody that as a woman, as a mother, like your mama bear fight for your kids and all the people you brought together, and even running for the Board of Supervisors. That's a huge, huge undertaking. And you went out there and you like went for it because you wanted the children of Los Angeles to be safe. And kind of tell me like how that got you there and what brought that, what brought you there to be at the point of like, look, somebody's got to do something. I'm going to do something. Not everybody has to run for Board of Supervisors, but we really want people to start voting and participating and kind of taking charge of the ship. You know, we've all been too apathetic and out of the game for too long. And that's why we're at, as far as I'm concerned. Anyway.
Exactly. So a wise person once told me, you know, elections are won by the majority of the people who vote. And we all think,
deep. Yeah, well, I'm amazed.
I know.
You know, the Democrats aren't buying into that because if you don't vote, I understand in L.A., allegedly, they're actually print ballots for you. But go on.
Well, but the truth is that what has happened with, and this is not just a Republican Democrat issue, because in the county of Los Angeles, one of the most populous counties, if not the most in the country, there are more registered Republicans in this county than any other county in the United States.
Wow.
Of course, we're outnumbered by the more Democrats there are registered than any other county in the United States. But none of it matters if you don't get off your tuchus and vote. And that voting happens for a month now. It is not election day. It's election season. And too many people that I met when I was running for office, and again, I did it because no one else would stand up for parents.
Yeah, and say what needs to be said.
Exactly. And too many people I would meet, and they go, yeah, I totally. You know, I unregistered, or I don't vote, or I don't bother. Well, you know what? You're going to miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Yeah.
And I feel like my role is more of that of a team mom. A real mother who cares is not just fighting for her children, but for all children. And it is just just horrifying to me how many people are letting one party, unchecked one party rule, which is basically letting public sector unions run our lives here in LA.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I completely agree. I grew up in Indiana. My mom got pregnant with me when she was 16 years old. She was basically, she worked in a bread factory her entire life. She met my father and her were 16 together, and obviously that didn't work out. She met my stepfather, and he raised me. And we lived on a working farm, and they both worked in factories. But one thing my mom always instilled in me was always do things for others, and it takes a village to raise a child. And I think in L.A., especially, because there's so many people afraid of being sued, afraid of being shut out by the public if they say something wrong, or, you know, there's so many reasons why we're afraid to just tell the truth. But the reality is that that is literally, we have a little schnafu.
Well, you know, I forgot to mention for the audience.
My phone
there,
dropped out. Sorry, right. I have to come back in.
And by the way, that doesn't mean Roxanne's calling in the show. For everyone out there, as we did last week, if you want to see, well, you don't want to see what I look like, but if you want to see two really lovely people, Angela and Roxanne are live in studio, and this is being pushed out as a podcast. So you could see inside the KEBC studios. You could see us talking. You could see me waving my hands. You could see Roxanne trying to get back on the air with her picture, for example. It's kind of a way to be inside. But let's go back to, yeah. I want to go back to you too, Angel, because you're a mom who cares.
Yes.
Roxanne is a mom who cares. There's lots of parents who do care. And, you know, it seems in a way that I'm not even going to say the Democrats. I'm going to say the extreme left takes advantage of the fact that people really do get busy, like, say, raising kids.
Right.
And you're not paying a lot of attention to what's going on. We're, say, raising kids. But, Roxanne, I know you found out during COVID, for example, just as a mom, when the teacher said, you know, we're not education. Why should kids show up for that? In fact, you should do it as a podcast.
Yes.
Right? You stood up against that. And tell us a little bit about that. It's an important part of being a parent, paying attention.
Well, yes. And what was completely horrifying in L.A. and shows you the unchecked power of the teachers' unions is in L.A. County, again, unlike any other of the, you know, thousands of counties in America, Barbara Ferrer, the public health department head, had the power. She colluded with the teachers union and Cecily Mark Cruz to shut down private schools as well as public schools. Let that sink in for a minute. So it's not enough that our property taxes are as high as they are. Thank God for Howard Jarvis that they're not worse, mm-hmm. but that you pay into a system that you cannot in certain neighborhoods use. Kids can die in, you know, in the race riots that they have in our neighborhood public high schools. My kids go to an independent school, and the LA Department of Public Health closed the access for people who were paying for outside schooling as well.
Yeah. Wow. I can't imagine. When I moved to LA, I was a single parent. I didn't have family out here. I came out to pursue a dream of acting, which I did do. Some things that are on IMBD, but the point is that I was able to have
rather small right now.
I was able to have a 2-bedroom apartment. I was able to work as a bartender, pursue my career, my dream, and raise my son. And it was not easy. Believe me, like there was in the beginning where I was cleaning apartments. I was doing whatever I had to do to survive and get on my feet. I cannot imagine if, when I was here, COVID hit, and they said, sorry, you're going to have to teach your kid online on no income, 3 jobs, so many single parent homes out there and multiple families living in apartments. It hurt the people that they say they want to protect the most.
Exactly. They claim that they want equity, which is, of course, not equality, and everybody gets those confused. But in so doing, they destroyed a generation. The repercussions will be so long-lasting because education is the key to your future,
absolutely,
your future earnings, and they just ripped that out from under children.
Well, diving into the circular argument, bringing your restaurant in, What's the name of your restaurant?
Pineapple Hill in Sherman Oaks, you guys. Please come out and try it. Come out and see us.
As I say every week, do have a Reuben. That's my favorite.
But it Cobb salad and potato skins, also very good.
Okay, we're going to have a food fight later, but let's do that off the air. It's interesting because not only by not letting kids go to school did it hurt the students, but, you know, as you could tell, look, I shouldn't be left unsupervised and I'm well over 18. Certainly kids under 17, 16, 14, their parents couldn't come into work at places like your restaurant because where are the kids supposed to go during the day, causing more economic duress?
This was an entire transfer of wealth and power, as if we didn't already have it, to the laptop class, to people, the kind of people who said, you know what, COVID lockdowns were great for me, and I felt like the environment was really doing well. We just got a ton of DoorDash and Uber Eats, and what's to complain about?
Right.
Well, if you were a senior who was isolated, if you were a kid who craved structure and learning, if you were, by the way, the people who delivered your DoorDash and made your food, they weren't locked down kicking back with the deliveries at all.
Right, right. They didn't have to experience it. What I love to hear is the average everyday person's story and how things affect them. And I have a gentleman who cleans for me who, to me, is Ivan, and I call him the Tony Robbins of cleaners, because the depression of trying to struggle and keep the business going. And I had single parents that were working for me and what they were going through. I would always talk to him. I'd have him out once a month and he would come in clean. And I have a very small apartment, so it doesn't cost me a lot. And it's just a feel good self-help thing.
And we'll be back in just a minute with SOS Los Angeles Family Food Little Guy 790 KABC.
I didn't.
Welcome back, everybody, to SOS Los Angeles Family Food and Little Guy, where today we focus on family. I'm Mike Netter. I'm always with Angela Marston here on a Saturday. And today we have Roxanne Hoge in studio talking and celebrating moms. I've got two, I'm not sure I'm fond of the term super mom, because you two are like superhuman beings, because everybody thinks their mom is a super mom. I thought my mom was a super mom. Hopefully, what my kids think is a story for another day. But you two also are political advocates. You do more than just take care of your own kids, which is why we're celebrating moms today. But you've been standing up for quite a long time for causes, et cetera. Roxanne, you did more than just run for supervisor and be on IMB. You literally have been out in the forefront of Los Angeles politics for not as long as you've been in IMB.
No. It's been a while. I think when I discovered and found it grossly offensive as an immigrant that I had chosen to go from a British subject, I'm no longer a subject, which you are if you're born in any of the Commonwealth countries, to a citizen. I took my oath to the United States and its constitution in the turn of the century in 2000. To discover that there was no opposition, forget meaningful opposition, there was no opposition, period, in many of the races where we're supposed to, we think voting matters, and actually it's way downstream of that. I mean, this last election that we had in LA County, there were 425 things on the ballot. 425. A lot of those were nonpartisan. But Republicans, meaning an opposite voice, were represented in very few of those. I'm happy to say that the party now has a new chair, and but again, it's a volunteer operation. We'll do what we can, but if you wonder, you know, who's going to save us in Southern California here,
no one's
we
coming
are,
to save you.
Hashtag behind the blue
the
curtain.
On Saturday.
Look in the mirror.
Right.
It's you.
Yeah. Nobody's coming to save you.
No one's coming. Like,
no.
We are completely, you know, in the submarine. We're taking on water. No one can get down here. We've got to save, you know, start bailing from within.
Yeah.
And, you
I
know,
totally
taking
agree.
The conversation, it's always interesting because, Angela, you spend a lot of your time, I'm going to say fighting the homeless, but trying to stand up, in a way, giving the homeless a voice so they don't, like, little things like die in front of your restaurant. Everybody should be
just
against
little things
that
like
that. Should
die.
Be a nonpartisan issue. I want to go on record right now and say that if you're NPP, Republican or Democrat, I hope your stance is against death.
Yes.
And you know, you try to speak up for people and do the right thing, and that becomes a little bit difficult, doesn't
it? I'm an independent, and I obviously lean more right. I've thought about switching many times, but I believe what's important is quality life and community, and that really trickles down to our kids and the elderly. And when you're dealing with something like homeless, it actually was my mother who's coming in, who I'm so excited about. She came in for 48 hours last year after my dad died. It was a very short time. And she always checks me and checks reality because she's just so honest and truthful.
That's what moms do.
I know. I mean, she used to have this thing when I was a kid. She's like, if you're going to do something when nobody's around, just know that everybody will know eventually. And if you can live with the consequences, then have at it. You know what I mean? She's always about telling the truth to the point where it's brutal. Like sometimes like, Mom, people don't need to hear that, you know? But she came in and there was a homeless person. And I know I think I brought this up last week. It was just filth, black, clothes, half naked at the airport. Her natural reaction was almost in tears and said, what is wrong with Los Angeles? What's wrong with people? This is a human being. And she was so shaken up by it. And again, it checked me in saying, how have we gotten to a point in Los Angeles where we are so numb to the human condition and to what's being done to our children and to the policies that are being passed that we're too busy to even vote or even, you know, participate in whatever way you can. I mean, we go by the three people that passed away on Van Nuys Boulevard, the woman that had passed away who was a homeless person I was having issues with. She was living in the parking lot where my business is. It's not that I don't care about her. I care about her deeply. She's somebody's sister. She's probably somebody's mother. I mean, these are human beings.
Yeah.
And we walk by with our Starbucks around the yellow tape and hurry up off to work. Or we drive by with our kids in the car and our kids are seeing this. You know, some of the kids are having to walk through this.
And people are learning the only way a human can cope with that is to ignore it. And shutting off your humanity here in the city of angels is very bad. You're right.
Yes.
You're completely right.
We all, when I grew up, my mom, like I said, she was very big. I remember I called her one day crying because, you know, look, I stood in homeless shelters. I was on welfare, which, again, for me, welfare enables you to not succeed, in my opinion. You know, that's a whole nother story for another day. I'm very much about giving a single parent all the money they need to get an education in a year or two. They can be a barber or a beautician. They can, you know, get them on their feet and then get them off the system. Give them a little hand up, which is what I needed at the time. And again, another story. But my mom always said, you know, I was crying. She said, Angela, you cannot do it on your own. She said, don't you think I had help from people? She's like, you have to reach out to other single parents. You have to, it takes a village. You quit trying to do it alone. And I don't know what it is about the lawsuits that we have going. And I think it has kept people, there's this invisible fence where we won't go and check up on our neighbor. Or we won't, you know, correct a child when maybe they're doing something wrong because we don't want to be, you know, accused of child abuse or child molestation or be sued. But we need each other. And we have such a diverse, amazing, I mean, look at how amazing you are and your background and where you've come from. And I come from Indiana. I often said when I was speaking on the news during the whole thing against Gavin is this isn't a race issue. This is a class issue.
Well, you know, it's a couple things. By the way, if you're watching the vodcast, you would see Angela said beautician and looked at me and then shook her head no, and I would agree with that. Just to understand if you saw the visual in this. But you know what's interesting is when you go back to 20, 30 years ago, we had, I'm getting to a point here, the Hare Krishna at the airport, right? And they annoyed everybody. Let's get face it, right? No, they did. And they sued for their right to speak up and discovered that it was public ground. But people cared about that because they were bothering them. Great point one of you two made there. I forgot which one because I'm getting old. But that we've kind of become immune to this. Yeah. They're homeless people and, oh, it doesn't seem to be something that we should react with compassion with. Angela, you said something to me very powerful when we first met a couple years ago. We had been speaking at some event up in Northern California, and you said, hey, you know, I'm an independent. And I said, that's great. I said, we've got the recall of Gavin going, and we're technically nonpartisan, but I'm like Roxanne, I am a Republican. You know, why are you hanging out with Republicans and during this COVID time of crisis? And what did you tell me? You said, well, Republicans are the only one that actually reached out to me about my restaurant.
They were the only ones that stood up, and they were the only ones protesting, and they were the only ones that had the courage to put their face to what they were saying. And, you know, it's interesting. Actually, when my video went viral, Donald Trump retweeted it. Trump Jr. retweeted it. I had a lot of influencers, liberal influencers. You know, they saved my bar. And I had gotten into a discussion with one of my bartenders. She's a Bernie liberal. And I had talked all over. And she's like, well, if a Democrat came and talked to you, would you do an interview with them? Or would you do? I said, I'll do an interview with anybody and I will talk to anybody. I said, but listen, here's how I'm looking at things. I'm drowning in a lake. And one person walks by and totally acts like it's a beautiful day and ignores me. And the next person walks by and says, holy cow, here, let me give you a hand. So where's my loyalty going to be? Where am I going to go?
Gratitude.
Gratitude. Loyalty. Like, these are the people that saw me when I was drowning and helped me when it did nothing for them. There was no gain for it. And that is something that my mom is a moderate Democrat. My mom's a moderate Democrat. She has voted differently in recent years. But that sense of what we were just talking about.
Well, we come back from the, it's fascinating to me because we talk about more Republicans in Los Angeles, Democrats. The biggest sector is really the biggest sector. They're slightly smaller than Democrats, much bigger than the Republicans are the no party preference. And the race you ran for, we'll talk more about that after break, is technically a nonpartisan race.
All of what's destroying LA is technically nonpartisan, they're all Democrats.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Technically, it's all nonpartisan. But the press doesn't seem, and I'm not picking on all the press, but you know who you are, seems to want to make such a big deal when people with compassion speak up with a voice, they have to be labeled. They have to be labeled what diversity they are, what church they go to, what political party. How about you, everyone out there, we stand up and fight in common? Because Los Angeles County, look around, is in crisis. And it's time that we stood up together. That's what this show's about. Stay in tune for another segment. SOS Los Angeles, family, food, and the little guy. Today we talk about family. 790 KABC. Welcome back, everybody, to SOS Los Angeles. Angela Marston, Mike Netter, and our special guest today, Family, Food, and the Little Guy. Before the break, we were talking about how there really shouldn't be a nonpartisan divide, but people like to paint it. And Roxanne, I know you want to weigh in on that.
Well, hands up, confession time.
And if you're watching the podcast, you can see Roxanne go up.
I volunteered for Bill Clinton's second campaign. I volunteered for Barbara Boxer. I thought that I was a liberal person and that sounded like a good word and that immigrants could only be Democrats. But I don't know if you've seen what happened just last week. A new Democrat club tried to charter out of San Francisco called the Democratic Family Club.
Oh, and they believe
their motto was, we want safe streets, safe schools, and safe sparks. Something like that.
What?
Right.
Wait.
What was
the motto again?
That's crazy.
San Francisco and the word safe?
And the word safe and they and
oh,
the word
that's blasphemy.
So they were triggered by the word family, I believe, and safe streets, and they were accused of being right wingers. And to Angela's point, safety, cleanliness, lack of corruption are not, should not be, right-wing values. Those should be the baseline that we all agree on. And LA used to be like that. And it is inconceivable to me.
That we've
gotten to a place where people act like it is nutballs to not want to be assaulted on public transit. Like, at the same time that LA County, by the way, reminder, supervisors, in case you don't know, those five women run LA, have a $36 billion with a B dollar budget.
43 now, went up.
They are advertising ad nauseum this week, again, using our taxpayer money, about Mental Health Month. Also celebrating Metro and please ride the Metro when every Metro train and bus is a moving mental ward. And these
and totally
people,
unsafe.
Totally unsafe.
Totally unsafe.
You cannot either you care about the environment and a 15-minute city or you're going to fight against crime. You cannot have both. You're either going to make things safe and livable or not. And if that means you're Republican, sign on up. LAGOP.org. Join Team Freedom. I'm here to welcome you.
Here's what really strikes me as, is again, as I often say, if you were a fictional novel about these people, go, nah, it couldn't be true. I talked about this on another podcast show I do on KABC. They did a kind of a survey of the metros. You folks know this, a couple of weeks ago, and they found that 800 people call them home. No, not because, hey, I spent a lot of time commuting. They call them home.
Yeah.
So instead of, and they cause, there's 800 people that ride them until they have to get off in the middle of the night. A small subset of those cause crime. And their response was, well, maybe we should buy them tickets. This was seriously, the supervisors are
yes,
like, okay.
Yes, of course it was. Of course it was.
Angela, here's what strikes me as strange for both of you. I'm really confused, sticking with the theme of Mother's Day. Where did it become wrong for the moms to speak up for the kids? But we, this frankly smaller subset of people called homeless, we can't touch them or say anything about them, but note the parents can't speak up for the kids?
It's just an absolute, you know, in Los Angeles, the way the laws are, even if you have a mother that has a child that's over the age of 21 that is dealing with schizophrenia, that child, when they are sent and committed, has to give permission for the hospital to be able to call and pick them up when they're done. And if that schizophrenic child who's over 21, who now has his own rights. 18.
And to get any medical information on your kid in California, the kid has rights at age 12. Back to your point.
No, but 12. It is like a cluster, don't want to say it on the air, of all these laws removed the parents' rights. They say it's all in the name of humanity. How is it humane to leave human beings out in this state?
You're hitting the nail on the head. And I think it's a bigger issue. You know, what's the definition of a conspiracy theory? Something that you thought 6 months ago. The fact is that California is the microcosm, the petri dish. It's their proving ground for these ideas that, and I hate to say, but it is for the Marxist takeover of the United States of America. And step one, you've got to destroy families. You've got to destroy communities. And we are seeing that here. So when people say, oh, you guys should leave, and God bless you for doing SOS California, but that's what... All right, well, you got to... All right, focus.
Let's
and then,
focus on LA County.
Yes, it is the pimple on the butt of the... of the
well, San Francisco might be a little worse, but we love San Francisco, too.
But LA is... I'm going to say LA is worse because they're infecting suburbia. Like, you sort of expect... And it's unfair to, oh, big cities are crazy. But LA, 10 million people in this county, I'll have a literal white picket fence in front of my house, and two blocks away, an RV had a meth explosion last month.
Right.
So
I don't
they're destroying
know,
everything.
Roxanne, I don't know how you do it with children here. I don't know. Like, again, I can't imagine being a low income single parent trying to survive here. I'm lucky my child is grown and out of the house. Unfortunately, I'm a casualty that a lot of people are experiencing. My child had to leave and move back to Indiana, where I'm from. I grew up on a farm in Indiana years ago where there was some backwardness, and I wanted to move to the culture of LA, pursue acting, and I wanted him to be well-rounded. I wanted him to be around different cultures, you know, experience things that would open him up. And basically, he couldn't afford to stay here. So he moved back to Indiana. I'm very proud. He has a wonderful, I have two grandchildren now, believe it or not. He owns his own home. He's thriving. Which, if you have a male child here, I'm sorry. As a mom, it's heartbreaking because it means a lot for a male growing up to be able to buy a home, to be able to, you know, take a girl out on a date. Or those are things that are their self-esteem, and it makes them feel like a man. And he's able to have that there, but then I can't be near him.
Yeah.
And that's a big problem right now with a lot of people that are, you know, second, third generation here. Their kids can't stay here and have grandkids where you can babysit them, you know. I would love to have, you know, my little grandkids here with me, you know, and be able to babysit now and then. And so that pulls on me to move back. But then I say, you know what? God put me in a certain position where I don't have that burden. So I have the time to pick up where other people can't. But we all have to do something because it's going to be a cancer that spreads across the country.
Yes.
Once it is solidified here, I feel like there's no way of turning the ship around. You know, I know we have other states fighting, you know, Florida, Texas, but we cannot succumb to pressure of terrorism. I hate to use the word terrorism. It's very drastic. But you can't be bullied into removing human basic rights.
We're under siege here in LA. And I think I said this the other day on Twitter, but I just, you know, as mothers, to bring the theme back, I find it fascinating that a 600,000 a year woman had the wherewithal and the right to, on a whim, shut down schooling and opportunity, not just for kids of color, poor kids, rich kids, what a kid, who cares? They're just kids. Yes. To shut it down, violating everyone's civil rights, your rights to run a business, my right to go to work, and yet kowtow to the ACLU and others who will not let you take a dangerous criminal vagrant, not an unhoused person, not my homeless neighbor. They are dangerous, drug addicted, mentally ill criminal vagrants setting fires, shooting up, defecating, having sex.
Absolutely.
And having and destroying the public areas, libraries, parks, sidewalks, all unusable.
The ACLU, what's happened to the ACLU? Because they are not for human rights. They are not fighting. If they truly cared, and I say this again with experience, I have a schizophrenic aunt and uncle. I've had to grow up around an aunt and uncle that has schizophrenia. And they are in Indiana, and they are very well cared for. And they actually live off the state. They're in a great home. I mean, it looks like a resort. They're cared for. If I found my aunt or uncle in the state that I see the homeless today, I would be so outraged. I would want to know who did this? Who put them here? Who isn't helping them? And unfortunately, you know, they just move the problem. As a small business owner, my area is doing great right now because I fight. But they're just moving the homeless down the street to another business. Where is the care? Where is our money going? Yeah. Show us the budget. You know, I do have hopes, believe it or not, for Mayor Bass, because I've met with her. And she has proven a lot of things so far. I know it's going the other way. But so that's why I say it's not about politics. It's about people and really assessing who's in our elected offices that are doing the right thing for
the right
people.
Thing. Just do it.
Just do it or get out.
After the break, I want to kind of give a blast on the fiscal budget in Los Angeles, so people really understand, it is SOS Los Angeles. A lot of talk about San Francisco because San Francisco has literally hit the point where, yeah, it's kind of obvious. Los Angeles, why we're doing this show, is county is on the path to that and part of the city.
Yeah.
Look, on a lighter note for everyone out there, you've got a mom, hug your mom. Sunday is the day when we celebrate the moms out there who gave birth. And by the way—
Or raise their kids.
And raise their kids. I was getting to a point. Slow down, mom. that no matter what the leftists say, only the moms can have kids and give life. And God bless. SOS Los Angeles, 790 KABC. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody. SOS Los Angeles, family, food, and the little guy. And we're focused on family today as we celebrate all the moms throughout Los Angeles, California, and the country. Look, before we went to break here and before I turn it back over to the two females in the studio, and by the way, I may need help getting out here. No, I'm kidding. Send food. What I think lost a little bit when you started off before the break, Angela, talking about Karen Bass. And Karen Bass isn't getting her budget granted that she wants to use for the homeless. Part of the reason is the LA City Council is saying, hey, we're kind of out of money because so much of our monies were coming from the feds last year. Shocking. Everybody knew that. Also, for L.A. County, which now has a $43 billion budget this year, it's gone up, Roxanne, but $3.5 billion of it is being reserved for potential lawsuits because the supervisors have mismanaged the way that people – it just goes on. And as you see San Francisco melt down, if you're not paying attention, which is why you need to vote and pay attention, L.A. County is, I'm not going to say inching, kind of moving rapidly toward that.
Yeah.
That's your cue, Roxanne.
Yeah, so we're mm-hmm.
If you could watch this on back as you would see me get the cue.
Slouching towards insolvency. I mean, the LA County Board of Supervisors spend so much time. They have a office of legal counsel with 300 lawyers and 600 assistants who spend all their time apparently making settlements and writing checks for things they screwed up. And that's why they're paying outside counsel right now, Shepard Mullen, shout out to the boys at Shepard Mullen, charging $800 an hour to defend the indefensible, Barbara Ferrer, to take away the civil rights of Angelenos. They can't even defend themselves. All the stuff that they're doing. And again, even voting is too late. People need to be aware. It's, you know, I know the race for president is super sexy, but your water board of supervisors, school board people, anyone backed by a public sector union that's not, I'll cut some slack for fire and police. Everyone else is completely corrupt. And so we have to pay attention to those races, the ones that you don't even know. Like, educate yourself. And what Angela does and what she has brought to people, that is motherhood in a nutshell, right? You have to be a little brave. You have to be the kid who stands up and says the emperor has no clothes, because what happens is being that one person, that first person, feels terribly frightening. And Mike, you've done it too.
Yes.
It opens up a logjam of people who go, oh, me too.
I know, but you know what strikes me is just I was in a conversation with somebody because political advocacy is what I do. I wake up and go at it this morning saying, I really don't even get how the unions are going to expect this to end. There won't, if people are not going to have jobs, if restaurants like yours shut down, if the movie business, the writer's strike, you know, starts to crumble, how – I'm kind of confused where the money is going to come from for these people to have jobs.
Public sector unions don't care. You're talking about writers? That's a private sector union.
No,
public sector employees got paid. They're suing right now over the debt limit, that we shouldn't have one.
You know, I'm gonna bring it back to – a basic, you know, I don't know as much as you guys know in a lot of areas, and a lot of people listening out there are in the same boat that I was at when I first joined this fight. What can I do? What do I know? I don't think that LA County is unsavable. I do think people like Roxanne, like you're saying, people need to vote, and people are hungry and they're waiting to have doings that make sense that they can manage to do to help turn the ship around. And one of them is just like Roxanne's saying, and she's very on point about it, is that we have to pay attention to our city councils. We have to pay attention to our board of supervisors and our school boards. And that is the first step in this battle, is getting everybody involved, voting, and paying attention to what these people are doing. Find out what they're voting against, what they're, you know, voting for, and believe that we can make change. We really can make change. And it's just going to be hard. It's going to be long. And it's not going to happen overnight. So we can't give up, you know? I mean, that's just truly how I feel about it. And I say that just saying that I've made very little progress in a year and a half, but I've seen progress. And that gives hope, which reminds me real quick, Mike, the one thing I called my mom and, you know, and she always said to me, I said, I don't know what I'm doing here. I just say, God, please speak through me. Show me what you want me to see and let the people know what they need to hear. Because who am I? You know, that was the thought in the beginning. I'm a nobody. Who am I to, like, I'm going to somehow change, you know, LA for everybody? It's not about me. It's about every single angel. And I call them angels. And there's lots of angel mamas out there, which is why we got to celebrate them. Poor and wealthy and in the middle that has to say no more, you know, no more. We are a huge county. We're one of the largest in the world. We literally can change the world in LA County. We can influence the entire state in California if we start being involved. And, you know, I don't want to go on, but there's a woman I met. Maybe we'll have her on. She said, you know, I know something's wrong. I want to start a cleanup group and get to know the small businesses. And so she started a cleanup group in Sherman Oaks on her own, getting people to volunteer to pick up trash and get to know the small businesses. And now that sounds like, well, the city should be responsible for that. The city should do that. No, we're beyond the government. All they do is mess everything up. So we need to get out the people that are doing bad things, get in people that halfway know what they're doing, and we need to start being involved like Roxanne has done. And in my journey, it's people like Mike Netter who picked up and went up against Gavin Newsom, and Roxanne out there putting her face out, even though she works in the industry. And that inspired me when I was like, oh, who am I? What am I doing? But it was just like Roxanne said, I read this book when I was a kid back in Indiana, and it's The Emperor's New Clothes, and they're naked. They're naked. Am I crazy?
You're not crazy. You're not alone. And bravery is contagious. And that's what we need to spread the word of. I mean, the moms that I met, well, we call ourselves Team Reality Moms, that banded together, and Julie Hamill, awesome, who is pro bono leading this lawsuit against the LA County Department of Public Health. She is, first of all, she's a badass hero. But second of all, she's lifted up on angel's wings by a team of moms who, when she gives us the information that was dumped on her, the reams of documents that from her records request or her deposition, and we comb through it. There's a lot of really great moms who are lawyers in there. I've only played one on TV. But people who go through the deposition line by line and go, hey, Julie, did you see this? Hey, remember this document? And we're connecting all the dots because we're going to take them down, because they did the wrong thing.
That's awesome. There is so much to fight for, and we can't save LA. And I also want to say, too, for everyone out there, celebrate your moms, but also everyone out there, stand up for your moms, too. Funny as that sounds, right? Your parents obviously did a lot to raise you. If you're out within the sound of our voice today, well, you're listening to KABC, you're doing something right. But literally, realize you're standing up for your family, just as you stand up for your kids. On Mother's Day, go out and stand up for your moms, right? Help us take back this. Really, I mean, it is a fabulous city. To the beach. We have Hollywood. We have spectacular scenery. We have the Olympics coming, for God's sakes. We have the World Cup. This is the second biggest city in what should be the shining jewel of the world. Yeah. And it's not a matter of an option. It's not a matter of moving. There is no one here to save you or your moms except for you. Political activism isn't a bad term. It's not even a choice anymore. You have to be out there. And God bless what you two are doing.
The recall people
came up, and it tugs almost your emotional heartstrings. We are an SOS. We've got 2 minutes left.
Let's
wrap this up for Mother's Day.
I just want to say, I know it's cheesy, but happy Mother's Day, Connie Helm, my mother, who had me at 16 and worked through a bread factory to raise me and fought for me and has given me the strength of who I am. And I hope anybody that has a mother, you even if you don't have any money, just hug her and say, Mom, you're wonderful, because we are so blessed to have the mothers in our life. And thank you so much for listening. I hope you guys will tune in every Saturday. And Roxanne,
thank you, and happy Mother's Day to Christine Crawford, who tells me no matter what, I'm always the best thing in any show she sees.
Everyone out there, God bless the moms who bring us life. And let's celebrate not only what we do, what mothers have done for their kids, but again, what we can do for our moms in this upcoming Sunday and beyond. Again, it's up to us to save Los Angeles. SOS LA, SOS Los Angeles, family, food, and little guy. Nothing is more important than family. I'll send an SOS to the world. I'll send an
SOS to the world. I hope that someone gets my... This show is furnished by Angela Marsden.